Good morning. On behalf of St. James Episcopal Church in Eufaula, Alabama, I'd like to welcome you to this online service of morning prayer. We're blessed by your presence and are so glad that you have taken time out of your Sunday morning to join us for worship. I am coming to you today from our nave for a very important and exciting reason. The word nave, many call it the sanctuary as well. It's our main worship space at St. James. The word nave comes from the Latin word, which means ship. Many times the ceiling of the nave looks like the hull of a ship, and we are the people of God on the ship of faith, sharing this voyage together. But I'm coming to you from the nave to announce this. Our vestry, our governing body of the church, has decided that September the 13th will be our first in-person church gathering, worship gathering, since we suspended services for the COVID-19 pandemic. That will be at 10:30 on September the 13th, and we will continue every Sunday at 10:30 with only one service for the time being. We have seen that the incident rate for COVID-19 in Barber County has leveled off and is beginning to decline, and we used that as our benchmark for when we would return to in-person gatherings. So, we're there, thanks be to God. So we hope that you'll join us on the 13th at 10:30. We will observe a strict safety protocol. We're doing our very best, or the best that we can, to secure to ensure the safety and health of all of those who decide to attend our services. We will ask all who do attend to wear a mask. If you don't have a mask, we will have disposable masks for your use. We will ask everyone to sanitize their hands coming into and leaving the church. We will also sanitize our church space before and after these services. We will also have certain pews marked off and certain seats marked off to observe a safe social distance. We will not have congregational singing, but our choir will be present, or certain members, to sing solos. We will have instrumentalists, and Daniel, of course, will play the organ for music during the service. We'll communicate more about the safety protocol as we approach September the 13th. We hope you'll make plans to join us, but if you don't feel safe yet joining us for in-person worship, we absolutely understand that and encourage you to stay home. If you feel that there is any safety concern that you have, we will have communion at this service, only in one kind, the bread only. We will not share the common cup, and we'll have observe a safety protocol for that as well. But if you don't come to church on the 13th but would still like communion from the common table, simply call the church office. We will have time after the service for those who are not able to join us or don't want to join us because of safety concerns to pick up communion after the service. All you have to do is call the church office and reserve your spot, and we will have communion for you. We are very excited that we can once again join together in person as a family of faith, a family of love gathered in the name of Christ. We hope that you will make plans, if not the 13th, then sometime in the future to join us. A few other announcements before we begin. We continue our conversation on race in America, the gospel, and the church. We have suspended that for 3 weeks. So that all in our group, and we encourage all to partake in a diocesan workshop on truth, healing, and justice that is sponsored by the Diocesan Commission on Racial Justice and Reconciliation. And it features really a world-renowned speaker and worker on behalf of racial reconciliation and healing, and that is Dr. Catherine Meeks, who is the director of the Absalom Jones Episcopal Center for Racial Healing. She will lead a dialogue on that. She will also do some presenting, and the last session will be on August the 26th. You may register for that workshop by going to the diocesan website. You may also follow the link on our website to register for that. We hope that you'll join the diocesan people from throughout the nation for that workshop. And then after that, join us again in September on Wednesdays for our conversation on race in America, the gospel, and the church. All of this is preparing us for our beloved community workshop that the Commission on Racial Reconciliation and Justice from our diocese will lead us in on December the 18th. Our food pantry remains open on Tuesdays from 9:30 to 11. If you know of anybody who is in need of food or food assistance, please have them come by on Tuesdays or call the church office. We want to help them. If you'd like to make a donation of food, we need food, you may make that donation of non-perishable items by simply bringing by non-perishables such as canned goods, peanut butter, pasta, rice, beans. Bring that by the church Monday through Thursday from 8 to 12:30. And if you'd like to volunteer to help man those food pantry hours on Tuesdays, simply call the church office. If you'd like to help with our virtual services, we will continue our virtual services or some of them after we resume our in-person gatherings on the 13th. We do need people to help man cameras and things like that on Sundays. Just give me a call or call the church office. We definitely need your help. And if you'd like to read either in one of our in-person gatherings or our virtual gatherings or lead Compline, call me. We would love to have you. Or if you have a musical talent, we would love to put you to work that way as well, sharing in that wonderful ministry and highlighting the talents with which God has blessed you. We will be announcing some Christian education offerings in the fall in the coming weeks. I hope that you'll look for that as well. And if you have any pastoral needs or a pastoral care concern of any kind, give me a call. My cell number is on our website as well as in all of our parish publications. I would love to hear from you, even if it's just to talk. And now, morning prayer. This is morning prayer for the 12th Sunday after Pentecost. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ. I was glad when they said to me, "Let us go into the house of the Lord." Dearly beloved, we have come together in the presence of Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, to set forth his praise, to hear his holy word, and to ask for ourselves and on behalf of others those things that are necessary for our life and our salvation, and so that we may prepare ourselves in heart and mind to worship him, let us kneel in silence and with penitent and obedient hearts confess our sins, that we may obtain forgiveness by his infinite goodness and mercy. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. Lord, open our lips, and our mouth shall proclaim your praise. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Alleluia. Let us say together the words of the Jubilate. Be joyful in the Lord, all you lands. Serve the Lord with gladness and come before his presence with a song. Know this, the Lord himself is God. He himself has made us and we are his. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving. Go into his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and call upon his name. For the Lord is good, his mercy is everlasting, and his faithfulness endures from age to age. And now the psalm and the first reading.
Psalm 124. If the Lord had not been on our side, let Israel now say, if the Lord had not been on our side when the enemies rose up against us, then would they have swallowed us up alive in their fierce anger toward us? Then would the waters have overwhelmed us and the torrent gone over us? Then would the raging waters have gone right over us? Blessed be the Lord. He has not given us over to be a prey for their teeth. We have escaped like a bird from the snare of the fowler. The snare is broken and we have escaped. Oh, help is in the name of the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. A reading from the book of Exodus. Now a new king arose over Egypt who did not know Joseph. He said to his people, Look, the Israelite people are more numerous and more powerful than we. Come, let us deal shrewdly with them, or they will increase, and in the event of war, join our enemies and fight against us and escape from the land. Therefore, they set taskmasters over them to oppress them with forced labor. They built supply cities, Pithom and Ramesses, for Pharaoh. But the more they were oppressed, the more they multiplied and spread, so that the Egyptians came to dread the Israelites. The Egyptians became ruthless in imposing tasks on the Israelites and made their lives bitter with hard service in mortar and brick and in every kind of field labor. They were ruthless in all the tasks they imposed upon them. The king of Egypt said to the Hebrew midwives, one of whom was named Shaphrah and the other Puah, when you act as midwives to the Hebrew women and see them on the birth stool, if it is a boy, kill him. If it is a girl, she shall live. But the midwives feared God. They did not do as the king of Egypt commanded them, but let the boys live. So the king of Egypt summoned the midwives and said to them, why have you done this and allowed the boys to live? The midwives said to Pharaoh, because the Hebrew women are not like the Egyptian women, for they are vigorous and give birth before the midwife comes to them. So God dealt with the midwives, and the people multiplied and became very strong. And because the midwives feared God, he gave them families. Then Pharaoh commanded all his people, every boy that is born to the Hebrews, you shall throw into the Nile, but you shall let every girl live. Now a man from the house of Levi went and married a Levite woman. The woman conceived and bore a son, and when she saw that he was a fine baby, she hid him 3 months. When she could not hide him any longer, she got a papyrus basket for him and plastered it with bitumen and pitch, and she put the child in it and placed it among the reeds on the bank of the river. His sister stood by at a distance to see what would happen to him. The daughter of Pharaoh came down to bathe at the river, while her attendants walked beside the river. She saw the basket among the reeds and sent her maid to bring it. When she opened it, she saw the child. He was crying, and she took pity on him. This must be one of the Hebrews' children, she said. Then his sister said to Pharaoh's daughter, shall I go and get you a nurse from the Hebrew women to nurse the child for you? Pharaoh's daughter said, yes. So the girl went and called the child's mother. Pharaoh's daughter said to her, take this child and nurse it for me, and I will give you your wages. So the woman took the child and nursed it. When the child grew up, she brought him to Pharaoh's daughter, and she took him as her son. She named him Moses, because, she said, I drew him out of the water. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Our first canticle is the third song of Isaiah. Let us say it together. Arise, shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord has dawned upon you. For behold, darkness covers the land, deep gloom enshrouds the peoples. But over you the Lord will rise, and his glory will appear upon you. Nations will stream to your light, and kings to the brightness of your dawning. Your gates will always be open, by day or night they will never be shut. They will call you the city of the Lord, the Zion of the Holy One of Israel. Violence will no more be heard in your land, ruin or destruction within your borders. You will call your walls salvation, and all your portals praise. The sun will no more be your light by day. By night you will not need the brightness of the moon. The Lord will be your everlasting light, and your God will be your glory. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. And now, the second reading.
A reading from St. Paul's Epistle to the Romans, Romans 12, 1 through 8. I appeal to you, therefore, brothers and sisters, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your minds, so that you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. For by the grace given to me, I say to everyone among you not to think of yourself more highly than you ought to think, but to think with sober judgment, each according to the measure of faith that God has assigned. For as in one body we have many members, and not all the members have the same function, so we who are many are one body in Christ, and individually we are members of one another. We have gifts that differ according to the grace given to us: prophecy in proportion to faith, ministry in ministering, the teacher in teaching, the exhorter in exhortation, the giver in generosity, the leader in diligence, the compassionate in cheerfulness. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Our second canticle is a song of praise. Let us say it together. Blessed art thou, O Lord God of our fathers, praised and exalted above all forever. Blessed art thou for the name of thy majesty, promised and exalted above all forever. Blessed art thou in the temple of thy holiness, praised and exalted above all forever. Blessed art thou that beholdest the depths and dwellest between the cherubim, praised and exalted above all forever. Blessed art thou on the glorious throne of thy kingdom, praised and exalted above all forever. Blessed art thou in the firmament of heaven, praised and exalted above all forever. Blessed art thou, O Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, praised and exalted above all forever. And now the third lesson, the reading of the Holy Gospel.
A reading from the Gospel of Matthew, Matthew 16, 13 through 20. When Jesus came into the district of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, "Who do people say that the Son of Man is?" And they said, "Some say John the Baptist, but others Elijah, and still others Jeremiah or one of the prophets." He said to them, "But who do you say that I am?" Simon Peter answered, "You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God." And Jesus answered him, "Blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father in heaven. And I tell you, you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not prevail against it. I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you lose on earth will be loosed in heaven." Then he sternly ordered the disciples not to tell anyone that he was the Messiah. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
God before us, God beside us, God behind us, God above us, be also now between us, a bridge through which your truth may move. In the name of the one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Who has the answer? Those words still can put fear into my heart. It reminds me of being a kid growing up in school and the teacher asking that question, expecting someone in the class to recite some fact or figure or something from a book that we had been assigned to read. And you remember the exercise. You would simply avert your gaze, look away, hoping that you didn't catch the teacher's eye, knowing that the minute that you did, "Mr. Coleman, why don't you tell us what the answer is?" They'd go down the roll or go around the room, and you just hoped that it would miss you that day. And it was usually because, or the fear was because, I wasn't prepared, that I hadn't done the assignment or I didn't know, and I didn't want people in the class to know that I was unprepared or that I didn't have the answer or that I was lazy or whatever it is. Well, that exercise is going on all over this country and this world now. All of my children have started back to school. I'm sure that most of you have or are preparing to do so, or those of you who have kids, whether it's in person or Zoom. And that question is being asked: who has the answer? Who did their work? Who knows it? And each year in school, the responsibility for the answer kind of increases, doesn't it? I mean, initially you're called on to recite some fact or figure or date or something like that. And then you graduate into the time where you're asked to tell what somebody else thinks about something, their answer for the question or for the problem. But eventually in school, it comes down to you. There's no more averting your gaze. There's no more sitting on the back bench of the class. You have to come up with an answer based on the knowledge that you have, the things that you have read, piecing it all together and answering what it is that you really think. And that's kind of where we are in today's gospel lesson in Matthew. Jesus is in a place called Caesarea Philippi. And I know you're thinking, oh my gosh, who cares about all these ancient places in the Bible? You know, they have these names, but it doesn't really impact who I am or how I walk with Jesus or my relationship with God. It just doesn't matter. All these, you know, the giant maps that you would see in the old Sunday school rooms that had dust caked on them because nobody ever looked at them. Well, it's really important today to understand where Jesus is, I think, anyway. And it not only has an impact on the disciples who were gathered around him in today's gospel, it has a dramatic impact on each and every one of us because the location speaks to us. Jesus is in a place called Caesarea Philippi. Caesarea Philippi was in Upper Galilee, outside of the domain of Herod Antipas. And it was an area that the Jews typically didn't go. It was a pagan area. They worshiped all kinds of other gods. And Caesarea Philippi at one time was a kind of a bustling area for this pagan worship. There were temples all around this valley to the various Roman and Greek gods. There was a cave that they believed Jesus was in front of when he had this conversation with the disciples that was supposedly the birthplace of Pan, the god of shepherds and the wilderness and desolate places. And they believed that this cave, it was the headwaters for the Jordan River, which was important for the life of the entire area. But they also believed that this cave was the gateway to the underworld. Basically, it was the doorway to hell itself. And so every year they would have these fertility festivals. So all of this debauchery was going on all over the area because they believed that the different gods from the underworld would come up. And so they would try to please them with all of this craziness. So this was a wild area. And some people believe that Jesus went there because people wouldn't recognize him so he could get some peace and could teach the disciples. But I think Jesus went there to ask this very question: who do you say that I am? Not what does the world want you to say, but who do you say? And he used this place to contrast that answer. The ways of the world, a place that worshiped wealth, a place that worshiped sex, a place that worshiped all of these things that were something other than the worship of God. They had all kinds of other gods, but not the God. And so Jesus asked the question, in the face of that, who do you say that I am? And so the disciples began to answer. They were in that early stage of school, right? Kind of mimicking what others said or what they thought they were supposed to say. They said, well, some say that you're John the Baptist, and others say that you're Elijah, and some say that you're Jeremiah. And Jesus says, no. Who do you say that I am? And Peter steps up and he says, you are the Messiah, the Son of the living God. He wasn't simply parroting what someone else said or what he thought he was supposed to say. He said what he believed and what his experience was and would be. And think about the courage that that took for Peter to say, you are the Savior, you are the Messiah. Not just, you are my teacher, or you are my rabbi, or this is what people are saying, but this is what I believe. And Peter would ultimately pay a price for that. It was a sacrifice to make that statement, to live that way, to allow his feet to carry him in the path of Jesus as the Messiah and the Savior. It would ultimately lead to his own sacrifice, his own crucifixion. You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God. And notice that when Peter says this, when he acknowledges who Jesus is, that Jesus told Peter who he was, told Peter who he is in that moment, and not just who he is, but who he is with God, that God infuses his future. You see, Peter knew that acknowledging God comes from knowing God and knowing the ways of God so that he could walk in those ways. Romans, our lesson from Romans, talks about discerning the will of God, and it begins in knowing him. Peter knew that as he acknowledged Jesus and who Jesus was. I hear all the time, well, what's God's will for my life? Or I believe that this is God's will for my life. There are Bible studies and books on discerning God's will for our lives. And so many times they skip over the part of acknowledging who God is, who God is in our lives and in our world. Romans goes on to say that it ultimately comes in offering ourselves, our lives, as a living sacrifice to God, all that we do, all that we are. And that can be hard to do. I know it can be hard for me. That's why this question convicts me so much, because there is something inside each and every one of us that wants to escape responsibility. We become like the politicians that we see on television. Not all of them, of course, but I know it's kind of cliche to use politicians, but oh well, they don't want to commit. You kind of want to work both sides and stay right in the middle. Might require something of you if you have to commit. Someone might say something about you if you actually commit. You might have to actually walk in a certain way if you actually commit. But at the end of the day, we are alone with our Lord. And Jesus asks us this question: who do you say that I am? Frederick Buechner, in a quote that I use very often, if you want to know who you are, as opposed to who you like to think that you are, take a look at where your feet carry you. We say a lot of things. We post a lot of memes on our social media. We talk the talk of faith. We position ourselves and our image as one of a child of God, and yet our feet and our mouths carry us in a totally different direction. A few years ago, I remember reading about a law case, a case that was brought against McDonald's Corporation and other fast food companies by the parents of children who were obese. They brought the case because they claimed that McDonald's was making their children obese. And in so many ways, that's very convenient, isn't it? And we do the same thing in different ways. We want to shift blame. We want to blame others. We want to avoid responsibility for our actions, for what we do. We are victims. And as a victim, what I say and do is not mine. It's not my fault. It's someone else's. And that is a convenient way to go through life, because it avoids change. And really, in many ways, it avoids life itself. But Jesus stands before us and asks the question, who do you say that I am? And we must answer it. And this becomes a question that convicts me these days, because so many times I know the ways of God. I love to read scripture. I know what Jesus is like. But I choose not to walk in those ways. Or worse, I just am silent. When I see someone who is being cruel or being mean or hateful or doing things that I know are against the ways of God, the ways of mercy and the ways of justice and the ways of love. And I simply say nothing. I turn a blind eye, hoping that I don't get called on because maybe people will think something of me. And in our world today, we worship so many other things. And I know it's cliche to say, oh, well, we worship wealth or we worship sex or we worship fame. That's a big one these days for young people, especially. We want to be famous. We'll do anything to get money or fame or whatever it is. But these days, we also worship convenience. We worship the economy. And we're willing to put up with all kinds of things, as long as our convenience is not infringed upon, as long as we don't have some kind of effect on our pocketbooks or on our taxes or on you name it. And we're experts at turning a blind eye, or at least I am, when it comes down to sacrifice. Just don't ask me to do anything. Just don't ask me to sacrifice. And I'll put up with a whole lot. And we can see what that's doing to our world, how it's dividing us, how it's separating us, how we live in a culture of cancellation, how we live in a culture where name calling is just accepted and we don't say anything about it. That's not the way of Jesus. Where we see a lack of empathy, that is not the way of Jesus. We say, well, I'm baptized. Well, that's not enough. I'm confirmed. That's not enough. I go to church most of the time, at least when I'm in town. That's not enough. I post things on my social media and I forward all kinds of things that certainly position me as a child of God and a person of faith. That's not enough. If you want to know what God is like, look at Jesus and the ways of Jesus. How Jesus had mercy on blind Bartimaeus and healed him. He is what God is like. How he looked upon the Canaanite woman and had compassion upon her and healed her daughter. That is what God is like. How he scooped up little children and welcomed them and blessed them. That is what God is like. How he took a man who was out of his mind and gave him life. That is what God is like. How he took a man who was in chains and ostracized by his community and made fun of and ridiculed and called names, and he brought him back. He took the chains off and reunited him with community. That is what God is like. How out of love he climbed up a hill and hung on a cross and died so that we may see God and be reconciled with that love. That is what God is like. And each of us can tell of our own experiences where God has given us light in the midst of darkness. And we know in our heart of hearts that is what God is like. But you will never know until you can answer the question, who do you say that I am? The will of God, our future and our future with God begins in that acknowledgement. It begins when we step into those ways, and it will require sacrifice, and it may require separation. And it can be a very hard question to answer, to answer it out loud in our lives. We stand in a modern day Caesarea Philippi, our world, and we worship many things: wealth, power, the body, and the list goes on and on. We stand with our Lord and he calls to us, waiting to show us the way, waiting to tell us who we are to show us his will. Who do you say that I am? Who has the answer? Amen. Let us say together the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. The Lord be with you, and also with you. Let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Show us your mercy, O Lord.
And grant us your salvation.
Clothe your ministers with righteousness.
Let your people sing with joy.
Give peace, O Lord, in all the world.
For only in you can we live in safety.
Lord, keep this nation under your care.
And guide us in the way of justice and truth.
Let your way be known upon the earth.
Your saving health among all nations.
Let not the needy, O Lord, be forgotten.
Nor the hope of the poor be taken away.
Create in us clean hearts, O God.
And sustain us with your Holy Spirit.
Your intercessions are invited either silently or loud. We pray for Donald, our president, Kay, our governor, Jack, our mayor, and all who govern and hold authority in the nations of the world during this time of challenge. Give them wisdom. We pray for our armed forces, first responders, and all of those who work to protect and serve our communities. Let us pray for our own needs and those of others, especially Chad, Jerry, Liz, Chuck, Susan, Shannon, Frida, Billy, Ruby, Carol, Connie, and Stella, and those you name silently or aloud. We ask your prayers for the departed, especially John and Evan. We give thanks for the life and ministry of Jo Watson as she celebrates her birthday this week, and Derek and Missy as they celebrate their anniversary this week. We pray for those who suffer as a result of COVID-19. Give them comfort and that healing that only you can give. We pray for those who work for a COVID-19 cure or vaccination. Give them wisdom and shine a light on their research. We pray for all doctors and nurses. Give them patience, wisdom, and a spirit of perseverance. We pray for the anxious, the lonely, those suffering from fear. Comfort them in the knowledge that you hold all things in the palm of your hand. O God, you made us in your own image and redeemed us through your Son. Look with compassion on the whole human family. Take away the arrogance and hatred which infect our hearts. Break down the walls that separate us and unite us in bonds of love, and work through our struggle and confusion to accomplish your purpose on earth. That, in your good time, all nations and races may serve you in harmony around your heavenly throne. through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Almighty God, for those cares and concerns we have spoken aloud, those named in our hearts, and those known only to you, we offer in the name of Jesus. Amen. A collect for the Jubilee year of the Diocese of the Central Gulf Coast. Lord God of all creation, fill us with your grace as we remember your kindness and goodness towards us through providence and through struggle. And let the trumpets proclaim the year of Jubilee, a year of the Lord's favor, as we dedicate ourselves to reorient our mission efforts to renew your gospel in our midst. May your Spirit inspire us, we pray, in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. The Collect of the Day. Grant, O merciful God, that your church, being gathered together in unity by your Holy Spirit, may show forth your power among all peoples, to the glory of your name, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. A collect for all sorts and conditions of people. O God, the creator and preserver of all humankind, we humbly beseech thee for all sorts and conditions of humanity, that thou wouldst be pleased to make thy ways known unto them, thy saving health unto all nations. More especially, we pray for thy holy church universal, that it may be so guided and governed by thy good Spirit, that all who profess and call themselves Christians may be led into the way of truth and hold the faith in unity of spirit, in the bond of peace, and in the righteousness of life. Finally, we commend to thy fatherly goodness all those who are in any ways afflicted or distressed in mind, body, or estate, that it may please thee to comfort and relieve them according to their several necessities, giving them patience under their sufferings and a happy issue out of all their afflictions. And this we beg for Jesus Christ's sake. Amen. At this point in our service, we would normally have our offering, where we would take up an offering for the life and ministry of St. James. If you would like to give to the life and ministry of St. James, we ask that you consider doing so by going to our website and our giving page. All donations are accepted. We have a capital campaign going on right now to replace our roof and a few air conditioners, so your consideration is also appreciated in that regard. Thank you again. And now, the St. James Choir sings our offertory.
Ready?
And.
Thank you.
let us pray together the general thanksgiving. Almighty God, Father of all mercies, we, your unworthy servants, give you humble thanks for all your goodness and loving kindness to us and to all whom you have made. We bless you for our creation, preservation, and all the blessings of this life, but above all for your immeasurable love in the redemption of the world by our Lord Jesus Christ, for the means of grace and for the hope of glory. And we pray, give us such an awareness of your mercies that with truly thankful hearts we may show forth your praise, not only with our lips, but in our lives, by giving up ourselves to your service and by walking before you in holiness and righteousness all our days. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be honor and glory throughout all ages. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Glory to God, whose power working in us can do infinitely more than we can ask or imagine. Glory to him from generation to generation in the church and in Christ Jesus forever and ever. Do not live in fear. Remember that God made you, God loves you, and God, in God's loving kindness, will never forsake you. And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be upon you this day and remain with you always. Until we meet again, either in person, which will be September the 13th, 10:30, or virtually at these services that will continue even after that time. God's peace and blessing be upon you this day and always. Have a wonderful week.
Reach out and touch somebody's hand. Make this world